In this video, we're computing the moment of inertia of a thin rod being rotated about one end, but this time the rod has variable density. So we're told in the problem that this linear density, and we normally call that lowercase lambda, is equal to kx. In other words, it's varying linearly and increasing from the left end to the right. So that x will be a distance from the rotation axis, and the k is just a constant. We're also told the rod has a total length of L and a total mass of M, and we want to express our answer in terms of those. So we want to write the answer in terms of the total mass and the total length of the rod. So before we get started, just a quick reminder of linear density. Again, we normally give that the lowercase Greek letter lambda, and that's the mass per unit length. So the units of linear density would be kilograms per meter. I also want to point out here that we can turn that equation around, and we can always compute a mass by taking a linear density and multiplying by a length. So we're actually going to use that second equation in its infinitesimal form because we're dealing with a changing linear density. So the next thing we do is slice this rod into point masses. And there's a representative point mass sitting a distance of x from the rotation axis. We call the mass of this thing dm, and we call the width of it dx. And now we can start building our expression for the moment of inertia contribution of this point mass. So we start by saying di, that's an infinitesimal contribution to the total moment of inertia given by this one little slice. And that's going to have the moment of inertia of a point mass. And that's just mr squared, or in this case, our mass is dm. And our distance from the rotation axis is x, so we have dm times x squared. Now we need to write down that little dm in terms of x. And this is where we get to this second equation where we were talking about linear density. I can always get a mass by taking linear density and multiplying by length. And because this linear density function is well defined at this one specific value of x, I can go ahead and write down kx, that's the linear density, times the length for this little slice, that was dx. And then we have an x squared hanging around at the end. Now just cleaning things up a little bit, I can write this now as kx cubed dx, and I have my moment of inertia contribution for that one little slice. So now we use integration to add up all of these contributions. So I'm going to say I, the total moment of inertia, is the sum of all the contributions. Those are called di's. And so plugging in our expression for di, we have the integral of kx cubed dx. And we're adding all these up from the left end of the rod to the right. And as we do that, x goes from 0 to big L. So this integral is no big deal. It's just a power rule kind of thing. So when I guess the antiderivative here, I end up with a 1/4 kx to the fourth. And we're evaluating from 0 to L. Now when I sub in the lower limit, I get 0. So I don't care about that one. When I sub in the upper limit, I end up with a 1/4 kL to the fourth. So that actually is an expression for the total moment of inertia of this rod, but we're not done yet because we want to write this in terms of the total mass of the rod and the total length. And this is where we end up having to actually do a second integral. So what we're going to do is do a mass integral for this rod. So I'm going to say the total mass big M is the sum of all the little mass contributions, the dms, just like in the diagram. And remember, those dms can be written as kx dx, that's the linear density times the length. And we're adding up all of those mass contributions from the left end of the rod to the right. And the whole point of this is that we're going to end up with an expression that relates k to m and l. And again, this is just a quick power rule kind of integral, so I end up with a 1/2 kx squared evaluated from 0 to l. Again, the lower limit vanishes, and I end up with just 1/2 kl squared. Now we solve for k, so we can sub that out in our expression for the moment of inertia. So we find that k is 2m over l squared. Now we can replace that in our expression for moment of inertia. And I have a moment of inertia of 1/4 times k, which we now know is 2m over l squared, times l to the fourth. And two factors of l are going to cancel, leaving us with l squared in the numerator. And a 2 cancels, leaving us with a 2 in the denominator, and we can write our final answer for the moment of inertia of this thing. It turns out to be 1/2 ml squared. Now it's interesting to compare this result to the result we got previously for the uniform rod. Remember, the result for a uniform rod rotated about one end is a moment of inertia of 1/3 ml squared, and 1/2 ml squared is bigger than that. The reason why is because we have more of our mass concentrated farther away from the rotation axis, because this linear density is getting bigger as we move farther away from the rotation axis. If you enjoyed this video, or at least found it useful, check out another one by clicking one of the links on the left, or click the Zach's Lab logo on the right to explore dozens of physics and math playlists. As always, you can leave your questions, comments, and requests in the comments section below, and I'll get back to you within 24 hours. Thanks for watching Zach's Lab, and best of luck on your math and physics journey.